Can I say I have a good feeling about 2025? Is that strange? Just because I love that number, 2025. I think that's a cool number. So I've had a good feeling about it.
All right.
Sorry to be positive.
You know who else liked 2025?
Project 2025?
Yeah, the people who wrote that.
Welcome to Millennial, the home of pretend adulting and real talk. I'm Andrew.
I'm Laura.
And I'm Pamela.
So, major outrage of the week, y'all. I cannot believe it. I was simply shocked when I saw that Joe Biden pardoned his only living son.
Oh, interesting way to frame it. Okay.
Yeah. Isn't that cruel? Well, he's lost two children. But this is the latest outrage of the week. Biden kind of made an about face by pardoning his son, Hunter, who, of course, was scheduled to be sentenced for his various crimes next month. And Biden said that he arrived at the decision over the Thanksgiving holiday. So, you know, family got together. They were sharing, you know, all of their warm, fuzzy memories with each other, really getting some good family time together, dreading the potential, you know, political retaliation that might be coming the way of anyone with the last name Biden. So they were like, let's just give Hunter a pardon, which, by the way, covers like 10 years. Covers anything he might have done from 2014 to 2024.
Wow.
But you know what I say? When I saw that, I was like, good, good.
Yeah, yeah.
Because honestly, it's like, listen, we're putting 34 felonies McGee back in the White House, and he's going to be pardoning himself and God knows who else, all the January 6th people. So I'm just like, I don't give a shit about this. It's gonna be a drop in the hat
based on like just the sheer number of people with, you know, wrongdoings in their past that Trump is already lining his own cabinet with. It's like, okay.
The only crappy thing is that now that Biden has done this, Trump gets to say, well, he did it, so why wouldn't I do it? Even though Trump was going to do it whether or not Biden did it for Hunter.
Right.
So
right.
That's my only hesitation about it. That's the only thing that kind of sucks. But we got to roll in the dirt a little more often, like the Republicans do. So I say let's play hardball like this a little more often.
Dude, honestly, I'm like, Joseph, you have like a month and a half left, my friend, and you got that presidential immunity. That's all I'm saying.
Well, I also kind of see this as a little teaser of things to come. Like, okay, this is step one. He's in don't give a fuck mode now that he's got a month and a half left. What else is he going to do? What other things is he going to, you know, whatever, what other executive actions might he perform over the next month and a half? We'll just have to wait and see.
Yeah. Well, we just have to remember that Trump can basically overturn anything that he does apart from pardons when he comes in. So there have definitely been pushes from various progressive senators trying to get Biden to take some executive action on things. But we just have to remember that he can do that now, but it doesn't mean Trump won't overturn it on January 20th.
Mm-hmm. And we basically saw him undo so much of what Obama was doing his first 2 weeks. So it's not above him at all.
No. And of course, Biden tried to undo things that Trump did too. I mean, it just comes around, never goes around. Cycle. I can't remember off the top of my head what was undone, but there were moves made after Trump left the White House.
Yeah. I mean, it's the reality we live in now. It's so polarized that it just feels like the pendulum is swinging one way and then the other every 4 years. And it's like a race to see who can undo the most shit that the other administration did. For another, maybe potentially WTF story, if we want to think about the about face on Hunter Biden that way, is martial law was declared in South Korea for a few hours today on the day of this recording, Tuesday, December 3rd. This was basically the consequence of their president being dissatisfied with the fact that he's not seeing his agenda delivered upon, decided that his parliament was conspiring with North Korea against him to prevent any of his agenda's progress. So he just decided to instate martial law it was pretty scary. I don't know if y'all saw any of the footage coming out of North Korea, but people were taking to the streets and protesting. The military had very quickly assembled like military rule, and there were lots of clashes between protesters. The military was even trying to break into parliament.
Wow.
It was really scary.
And this only lasted like 5-6 hours, right? Yeah. It was pretty quick.
Yeah, but it's the result of a president who is continuing to plummet in his popularity and is up against an opposition parliament who kind of has him in some gridlock right now. We know something about that in the United States. But, you know, given the fact that we have a president-elect coming in who has openly talked about using the military to carry out mass deportations, using the Insurrection Act to deploy the military on protesters, it is very disturbing to see something like that play out so close to when we're going to have a new commander-in-chief over here.
That was my thought, exactly. It's hitting a little too close to home right now.
Little bit. Happy end of 2024, I guess. Like, it's just, I'm gonna be glad to see it go, but I just feel like I'm buckling in for 2025 because I just don't know.
Can I say I have a good feeling about 2025? Is that strange? Just because I love that number, 2025. I think that's a cool number. So I've had a good feeling about it.
All right.
Sorry to be positive.
You know who else liked 2025?
Project 2025?
Yeah, the people who wrote that.
Well, speaking of the end of the year, of course, there's all these like end of year lists and whatnot, and we're all bracing for our Spotify Wrapped and our Apple Music reviews and all that. But Oxford and Dictionary.com released their words of the year. Oxford's was brain rot. And their runner-ups were lure, demure, romanticy, dynamic pricing, and slop, which I don't think I've heard that word this
year. No. Why the hell was that in the running? I don't think this was ever a viral term.
Maybe it was a Gen Z thing, and we're just over the hill and missed it.
Maybe. Are we that old?
Yeah. Sometimes Chloe gives us words and I'm like, I don't under what?
Yeah.
What are you talking about?
Well, I'm looking up slop on Urban Dictionary right now. Oh, okay.
Uh-oh.
I see. Okay. Well, there's a couple of definitions on here. One is about a sex act. The other is about pie. So I'm guessing it's definitely the pie definition, right?
Or is it a sex act using a pie?
You know, I think I saw that in a movie once.
Yeah. Dictionary.com's was demure. This one actually, so everybody, well, most people probably know there was this woman on TikTok and she's saying she's very demure. She's not like the other girls. She went viral. I guess it was over the summer. I actually like this one for word of the year because, yes, it was born out. The virality was born out of this TikToker, but it's actually stuck, at least for me and people I know. People are still using the word demure, whereas I don't see people using brain rot too often personally.
It's a very fandom term, and I actually don't really like it because I feel like it's been around for a long time if you like exist in online spaces on the internet. Like it's like that is like a very fandomy term. So it's like, say, like you might say like, oh, I have survivor brain rot because I've been going down a rabbit hole coming up on the finale, you know, so you hear it more there. But I actually feel like this one's kind of fallen out of favor. At least demure is like more recent and you can like specifically tie it to 2024.
Yeah.
Update on slop, Laura. I don't think it's one of those Urban Dictionary definitions, at least according to the New York Times. It refers to art, writing, or other content generated using AI.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So I see Brock in our Discord is calling that out actually as well. Thanks for that, Brock. Well, that's not as fun as like the sex act and or the pie definition.
Any other words of the year that stick out to you two? Like I said, I think mine really is demure. Like I have been using it.
So anytime I think about this, and I've been thinking about it for the last couple of days. I keep coming to the same conclusion that my word of the year is welp, like an old cowboy just chewing on some sunflower seeds, being like, welp.
That's it for America. Welp. It's all over now.
I don't even think it's just America. It's just the world. I'm just like, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Do you have one, Pam?
I don't. But I do. I'm fine with demure. I like romanticy, too. I feel like that really, I mean, again, it's not necessarily a new term, but I feel like it's risen in mainstream popularity this year, especially with the success of Fourth Wing, kind of bringing it into the forefront. I like lore as well. I think that's really fun. I think it would be between those three, I guess, if I'm just looking at this list here from Oxford.
Okay. Dynamic pricing was not a good pitch for word of the year. That's just a thing that's gone on.
Yeah. That seems to me like it would be Time's person of the year, you know?
Oh, like, yeah.
Dynamic pricing.
The enemy.
And was dynamic pricing more of a talking point last year?
I think so.
Yeah. Especially with like the Eras Tour, really, like that was like, I mean, it's still going, but that really kicked off last year. So yeah, that would, I would have tied it to that as well.
So today we have a listener feedback focused episode. And before we get into that, just a quick reminder about our new merch store at shop.millennialshow.com. Lots of great merchandise options available there, but I just wanted to say that there was a request for the show t-shirt. We had a long sleeve, we had a hoodie, but not a t-shirt. One of our listeners asked for one. So we made one with a Comfort Colors heavyweight shirt, and it's available in a few different colors. So check that out if you want a For the Show t-shirt. By the way, Comfort Colors has been a very popular brand in recent years, so I'm looking forward to ordering this myself. The New York Times wrote a whole piece on it. It's like a viral shirt.
I have a bunch of like a lot of like my newer band t-shirts, like from concerts, are printed on Comfort Colors. They're a little bit more expensive, but I have noticed that the quality is really nice.
Yeah. Yeah. They look great. So definitely check those out. Listeners, you can see all of our items that we're selling at shop.millennialshow.com. Oh, Laura's got her whiskey glass.
It arrived today.
So cute.
So I was like, I'm just going to sit here and take surreptitious sips as Andrew is walking through the plug for the merch store. And if it doesn't get called out, I'm just going to hold it up and cheers to the listeners. So cheers.
What's
y'all
in that glass?
Angel's Envy bourbon.
Oh, hey now.
Oh, I like Angel's Envy.
Hey now.
It's good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Very cool. Yeah, that glass looks great. It's got our hash pal on it.
Yeah.
So time for our listener feedback. And I want to start with some comments about the Smart Mouths episodes that we've been releasing from the vault, because listeners have been sounding off after listening to these on our Patreon. This is one of our newest benefits at patreon.com/millennial. The Smart Mouths series has been stored away. That was one of our earliest podcasts that launched in 2009. But we're starting to bring it out of the vault through our Patreon. Megan said, this is my favorite benefit. What a nostalgic blast from the past. I remember being here live for episode 10, the hallway poo origin story. Oy vey.
Is that where it came from? Maybe I'll have to listen to episode 10.
When I posted that on Patreon, I didn't realize that was the episode where it occurs, where the story is shared for the first time.
Oh my gosh.
Tiara added, I've randomly remembered that shit the pants in the hallway story many times over the years.
Andrew, the lore has really stuck with everyone.
Need a shirt with that on it.
Know the lore.
Pooping in the hallway. Yeah. Alex said, the discussion around being able to curse on the new show, but not being sailors had me cracking up, especially knowing what was coming in the future around 2016. The discussion about whether Obama would potentially become part of pop culture was so interesting to look back on from a 2024 perspective as well. And I think that's one reason people are liking listening to these. It's like a time capsule.
Yeah, that really is.
Oh, sweet summer children. We had no idea.
Speaking of children, Shelby said, not Laura introducing herself as a college sophomore. I somehow forgot how long ago this was.
Baby.
I know. And I'm sure at the time I felt like I was so mature and so grown up and I had it all figured out and I had all the best opinions. Not.
And finally, just want to add that Jay DM'd us on Instagram and she said, my will to remain alive will be sustained if y'all re-release imprint episodes.
Ooh.
All right, Jay, noted. Maybe after Smart Mouths is finished, we could start releasing some of those.
We also, as a follow-up to our gift guide episode, wanted to ask our listeners in our Facebook group if they have any unique shopping plans this year outside of big box stores or retailers or Amazon, mainly because I am personally trying to decrease my reliance on Amazon this holiday season. No judgment to anyone who needs to stick with it for the time, the convenience, and everything that comes with it. But I've just been very disturbed by the events of the last couple of months, and I really want to try and get outside of my comfort zone for shopping this holiday season. So I was really looking for some tips and advice, and we got some great ones in our Facebook group. Our first one came from Katie, who said, I'd been planning to buy most of my gifts off Etsy. However, this is a nice pro tip. You need to be careful to go through the profiles of each seller to make sure they are actually handmade. They have a little more transparency now by saying made by or handpicked by and such so that you can differentiate. I know we're trying to stay away from Amazon, but if you must, try Amazon Support Small for third-party retailers and small business owners. That's a really great call out.
Yeah, it is. And that's a really good tip about Etsy. I didn't realize that they had those little flags on the listing, so I'll have to keep a close eye on it going forward.
Karen says, here in Baltimore, we have a really cool pop-up downtown called Made in Baltimore, and they sell all kinds of goods that are, well, made in Baltimore. I went on Saturday for Small Business Saturday and bought a bunch of stuff, and I also bought some stuff online from a shop I found there last year called Han's Honey. It has taken me several years, but I'm finally building up a decent repertoire of local businesses that I like to buy from every year. I suggest looking around at your local area to see what kinds of small business things they might be doing. I know we have a lot out here on the East Coast. Yeah, that's, I love that tip from Karen. I try and go to the craft fairs around here when I can, or a lot of like the smaller shopping centers sometimes will do like makers events. You know, so if they're if they have inventory from local makers and suppliers, then they'll give them like some space to set up outside their shops to display more stuff that you can purchase and stuff like that. But yeah, this is the season for craft fairs and all that good stuff. So highly recommend checking out some of those online calendars for your cities.
That's a good way to find local businesses. And I noticed this past Small Business Saturday, some Las Vegas-oriented social media accounts were asking their followers, what small businesses do you love most in Vegas? So that was an easy way to just look through the comments and find some places that I hadn't heard of before.
Yeah. Or like Liza, most people said, know like the cool like streets, you know, like San Francisco has some trendier streets and stuff like that. So if you look... Mm-hmm. For stuff like that, you'll usually be able to find some cool shops there.
Or like First Fridays. Vegas has a First Friday with a lot of local businesses.
Yeah, this was pretty common feedback too. We heard from Melissa, Stephanie, Art, and Chrissy, who recommended local vendors, craft fairs, and makers markets like that. So lots of good feedback.
Liza said, three stores I'm excited to support. One is Good.Store, obsessed with their plastic-free, actually effective bar soap, unscented for me, and shampoo bars, Juniper Pine, with all proceeds to inspiring charity to reduce maternal mortality and TB. Number two, Earth Hero is a nice hub for lower waste type stuff with subscription options. Number three, actually giddy about a badass Ohio-based LGBTQ+ historically inspired designer who made pants for my exact body type. And the URL is idodeclareshop.com. And also, I still use Amazon, and I'm not here to shame anyone. It's rough out there. We're getting by somehow.
Yeah, for sure. hey, listen, it, especially if you're a busy person, and you can get some good deals on Amazon. I mean, like I said, I'm still doing some shopping on Amazon this year. I'm just trying to not make it a 100% Amazon Christmas like it has been in the past.
And by the way, I'm realizing what this domain spells out. There were no uppercase letters. So
I do declare.
Yes. Shop. Yeah. I do declare shop.com is where you can go.
Elisa says, last year, my overall theme was gifts from used bookstores. This year, it's going to be baked goods with recipe cards. I actually love that. That's so cute.
Yeah. The recipe cards are a really nice touch as well.
That is a really nice touch.
Alexandria says, the last couple of years, I've really enjoyed giving subscription boxes as gifts. They can be a little pricey up front, but essentially it has ended up being a gift for multiple people with one purchase. A few examples, like on my in-laws, an Atlas coffee subscription. And for my parents and brother, I've done Universal Yums and Finders Seekers, which is an escape room type puzzle box. Good Store, formerly Awesome Socks / Coffee, and run by John and Hank Green, also has socks, coffee, tea, and soaps. Yeah, I love this idea.
I also like it for when you're in that situation where your friend or family member has a birthday really close to the holidays, because then it's kind of stressful to come up with multiple gift ideas. So with this, you're killing two birds with one stone, potentially.
That's a good idea.
Like, yeah, I'm spending more on you, but this counts for your birthday as well, which is like a week after Christmas. Pat's is in February, early February, and that's difficult for me. I got to come up with Christmas gift ideas, and then like 6 weeks later, birthday gift ideas.
Yeah, my sister's birthday is January 2nd, so it's I've definitely forgotten.
Yeah.
As a week before Christmas baby, I feel her pain.
Yeah, it's tough out there.
Yeah. Definitely is. I love this idea, though. We did this for my dad a couple of years ago. We got him like a monthly whiskey subscription. So he would get like little mini bottles of different whiskeys to try every month. And my mom got us one of those like escape room puzzle problem type kits where we were trying to solve a murder, and we would like get a new clue to the puzzle delivered every month. So that was a nice family gift.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Nice activity.
And lastly, Sarah said, I like to paint gifts for a lot of people at my local Color Me Mine. I usually paint at least several gifts I give out for birthdays and Hanukkah. That's another great idea.
Yeah. It's a really nice way to give something a personal touch.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You really put time into that, too. So that's meaningful as well. All right. Well, thanks, everybody, for that feedback. And we're going to take a quick break. But when we come back, we'll get to some more feedback we've received about recent episodes. So we'll be right back.
So our first piece of general feedback comes from Tiara, who writes, hi all, a follow-up to this week's episode. I figured as a content creator on TikTok, I would put in my two cents. When I joined TikTok in 2020, TikTok Shop wasn't a thing yet, and I was posting my reviews without getting any money from sales or from the companies. As my channel grew, I started to make some money from the companies, but on a flat rate basis. So my reviews have insane views on them, and I got zero financial benefit from them. Now, to this day, I'm still not a TikTok shop girly. However, I will be signing up tonight. Turns out some of the companies I have been reviewing for years now are on TikTok Shop, and people have bought their items from my reviews. Again, I made zero money from those sales. Halara is a big one for me. My reviews have always been honest, and I will only add the shop link to items that I actually love. I did the math the other day, and some of my videos could have potentially made thousands off of. Sigh. I want to maintain my honesty, but that money would sure have been nice, you know? It depends on the creator, I guess, but I will be adding commission links to items I love that I would have posted about anyway.
Hell yeah.
And this is in regards to a discussion we had in After Dark. We were talking about the TikTok shop and how it's difficult to trust people. But, you know, Tiara really cares about her audience, her brand. Yeah. I'm sure there's plenty of people out there who are genuinely trying to sell products. But the thing is that when you're just flipping through the feed you're being introduced to creators you've never seen before, and they're trying to push all these random products, and they might do a good job of selling you on it.
Some people don't even have the products. They're like, I don't have it. I just have a, but it looks like this. It, you know, it's getting crazy out there to that point. But I think that, like, at the end of the day, you know, Tiara, you have a built-in audience that trusts your reviews. So of course, like, you should take advantage of that and make that money. But it's hard when you're just like scrolling and you don't recognize, you know, one person from the other, and all you see is like people trying to convince you that it's the best thing they've ever bought.
Yeah. But get that coin, Tiara. We trust you. Yeah. All right. This next piece of feedback comes from Chris regarding Laura's Dogecoin. We were talking about Laura holding on to her Dogecoin. It's made a lot of money for her. And Chris said, I felt like that with Tesla stock, Laura. I have held for a few years, and my opinion of Musk has really soured since he took over Twitter, and now I can't stand him. Feel dirty holding them. I ended up selling, and I'm thinking of donating some of the gains since the election to charity. Aw.
Yeah.
That's nice.
That's what I did.
Yeah. You have sold it now? It's been sold?
I have sold it. Yeah.
Oh, end of an era. How long were you holding on to that for?
Oh my gosh. I bought it in 2020. So,
wow.
Yeah, about 4 years at this point. And I mean, most of the time it sat there just kind of flatlined, wasn't really diving or climbing. But then after the election and the announcement of the Department of Government Efficiency, and that wasn't the only reason, the Fed also cut rates, which impacts the stock market. But anyway, Doge shot through the roof, and it felt icky.
Yeah.
So I was like, you know what, I'm going to sell this, and I'm going to donate some of the gains to charity. So I'm still figuring out. I like have it earmarked. I'm still trying to figure out what I want to donate to, but that is my plan.
Chris, as I'm sure you know, Tesla stock has popped since Trump won the election because of Elon's close relationship with Trump. So you'll be able to hopefully make some good money off of that. I left Tesla a couple years ago because I couldn't stand the Elon roller coaster and Elon anymore. Love the car, hate the guy. And now we have a bunch of feedback regarding our post-election episode.
Yeah, so our first piece of feedback comes from Brianne, who says, thanks for the episode, everybody. Teaching in a purple public high school today was one of the hardest days of my 10-year career. Kids celebrating with their MAGA gear, kids sobbing, kids asking, do I not matter because they are a minority? I never want to experience today again. I needed the comfort of this episode after the last 24 hours. This is rough.
Yeah.
I feel ya.
I was listening to a teacher-oriented podcast who were talking about how the kids were doing exactly what you are describing, Brianne. Half of them celebrating, half of them being really upset. And I have to say, I would not have guessed that. I did not realize kids were so in tune with politics at certain grade levels. Maybe in tune isn't the best word, but following it at all.
Well, they just hear from their parents, I think, too. I don't think that, like, depending on the age, they're very closely following it, but it's kind of like any other sports team.
Mm-hmm.
And that really is what it's become. Mm-hmm. It's the total sports team mentality.
Rachel says, this episode made me feel not better because that's impossible, but comforted. I'm going to remain hopeful that we can get through this.
Julianne said, just subscribed to Millennial Patreon alongside my MuggleCast one. This was exactly the comfort episode I needed to feel, aligned with people who share similar thoughts, in shock and despair about everything with the election, and have other major life stressors flaring up at the same time. You guys and David Pakman have been a huge help. We need to support independent media. Yeah, after the media played us and social media played us, we need to really support independent media. We are not journalists. I would hesitate to even call us independent media, but support creators who help you feel better about things. And I'm glad people liked that episode so much. I will remind you all that I was very hungover when we recorded that. It's a very painful episode for me to get through, and I'm still shivering at the thought of doing that. And then
it was a rough day, man. And our last piece of feedback comes from Drew, who said, well, that's disappointing, right? Sometimes it feels like hope and humanity can't be saved. Now that we are stuck with Dawn for a bit, I think discussion must be done about the DNC and the Democratic platform. I think there's been a huge lack of confidence in the DNC since they picked Hillary over Bernie in 2016. The support for Bernie was nuts. Then with Biden next go around, he was already struggling with his age. Come 2023, and they send him out for slaughter on the debate to use that as a reason to get him off the ticket. We the people didn't really get a fair shot to pick the true candidate in the primary as a result, even though Kamala is light years more qualified than Trump. I think a combination of all that plus too much of America, unfortunately, not being willing to pick a woman as president yet is what cost us. They need a complete overhaul on their tactics and outreach. Being the moral and logistical choice is not enough to win anymore. Being the moral and logical choice is not enough to win anymore. I was just interested in your thoughts on the topic. I look forward to hearing the latest episode. Your voices since MuggleCast inception have been a steady therapy all these years. Yeah, I agree. Democrats definitely have to rethink their messaging. I think it's going to take a little while for them to figure out what that even means. And I will kind of push back on the Bernie Sanders rhetoric here. I remember I became very unpopular with the listeners we have who are more progressive than I am, because I was never a huge Bernie Sanders fan. The DNC did not pick Hillary over Bernie. Hillary won the primary season. She simply got more votes from more people during the primaries. We have to be able to accept these realities as we move forward. With that said, I don't want to relitigate 2016. And I think Bernie Sanders has some great ideas. It's not that I don't like him. It's not that I wouldn't want to see him involved or see progressive candidates like him involved. Ideologically, I'm right there with him, like 95% of the time. But I think we need to be honest with ourselves and not sort of fall into confirmation bias of, because we felt like something was huge, that must have meant that it was huge, right?
Which is basically what we saw in the lead up to this past election. Yeah, we were feeling really good based on what we were seeing online. And it wasn't even the polls. It was all the chatter on social media. And we've talked about that.
And I mean, there's a lot, like even in our Discord right now, Justin, like a lot of people have different thoughts about this, but Justin is saying it's Joe Biden's fault, not the DNC. The DNC does have its shit too, he does acknowledge. But yeah, I think there's a school of thought here that Joe Biden was really resistant to being a one-term president. And I think that's part of the problem. I think the fact that the party didn't get involved sooner to force his hand if he wasn't willing to step aside is also a problem. But I honestly, I think the fact that we like high road everyone and play like moral superiority police, but then we're the ones who put an old man who's clearly not in like the cognitive state of mind to be able to do a national debate like that. We did that. We are the ones who put him out there. It's really hard for us to claim the moral high ground when we're doing stuff like that. And yeah, we definitely have to rethink that.
Well, and Biden also should have stepped down 2 years ago and given us time to run a primary and let somebody naturally surface to the top instead of him immediately endorsing Kamala like 4 months ago. And there's a lot of errors.
Yeah.
But that's all of our political feedback for today. This next one comes from Becky. Hi, Andrew, Laura, and Pam. Just listening to the Variety Show on Patreon, and I was so happy to hear libraries come up. I'm very thankful you are spreading the word about Libby because it is a great resource. And for anybody who doesn't know, Libby lets you borrow ebooks through an app, and you can send them through to Kindle and other places. It's great. As a public librarian, I wanted to share some tips and explanations for some of the questions you all had. Pam was absolutely right that many libraries will enforce area/residency requirements because of wanting to prioritize the people in their community. A library like LA might have a lot more of a budget, but in general, we're often scraping by. This is still relevant for digital items because we still often have to pay for each individual checkout. For Libby, when we purchase them, most books have 26 to 52 checkouts on them before they expire. So if we let everyone in the country have a card, we'd have to spend a lot more money to have books available on Libby. Hoopla, that's another app, works differently than Libby. I think Andrew mentioned that he thought the waits might be shorter, and that's because there is never a wait with Hoopla. On Libby, depending on the publisher, you get a limited number of copies or a limit on how many people can borrow something at the same time. On Hoopla, everyone could borrow the same item at once. The library pays per checkout rather than per item. Hoopla doesn't always have the mainstream stuff, but it's always worth checking. They have the Harry Potter audiobooks, which is great. Also, the titles available on Hoopla are the same for all libraries, no matter where you are. What's available on Libby for you varies depending on what your library chooses to purchase. So those were some key points from Becky. Thank you for sharing all that, Becky. We appreciate the information. And I think I said on that variety show, or maybe on the main show, that that's like my app of the year. That is my new thing of the year. And Pam's been on this on the Libby train for a while, but I'm really using it this year and just loving how easy it is to borrow books. Yeah.
You don't even have to go to the library. It just comes right to you.
And I send them to my Kindle. It feels like I bought the book. Yeah, but I didn't.
Exactly. It's nice.
Yeah. All right. Well, we now have some confessionals, but first we are going to take a quick break and we'll be right back.
Okay, I'm so excited to read this one. The drama the drama is incredible in the way that it's written. So it's caps lock. So I'm going to try to lean back from my microphone so I don't so I don't blow y'all out. Why do I wink at random people? Oh my Lord, y'all, it's so embarrassing every time. Why did I do this? I just winked at a coworker and I don't know what happened or why. Not like in a sexy way. I literally wink at everyone. I'm embarrassed always. Seriously, I do it to my kids or husband, and I guess I don't care about that. All other times I want to hide or melt into the floor. And yet I keep doing it. It's like a response to someone smiling at me. Old lady at the store, coworker, neighbor, literally anyone and everyone. And then the confessional writer included three melting face emojis. Didn't know where to put this. What a fun quirk that probably offends people that I am actively trying to get rid of and for some reason cannot. So I felt the strong emotion coming off this confessional. And I gotta say, I don't think it's that big of a deal that you wink at people.
Well, no. I don't know if I agree.
Yeah. But I feel like if your goal is to like end the conversation, you're probably going to disarm them enough by like just winking at them for them to go away or for you to walk away. So it works twofold.
It is a really funny tick to have. I would hate if I had this and like seemingly couldn't control it. Maybe it's like a nervous reaction type thing. Are you like a little socially awkward?
Yeah, I don't know. I do personally know some people who tend to wink. Like it's just part of their nonverbal communication cues. And I just feel like if contextually appropriate, I don't feel like it's a problem.
April supports you, confessional writer. She says, I have to say, it makes me chuckle if anyone winks at me.
Yeah. If someone winks at me, it makes me feel a little like giddy. I don't know why. I'm too. Like, oh, that person, like, they have a good sense of
humor.
They're
hitting on me. That's why you're feeling giddy?
No, it's not even that. Like, I don't know.
I feel like it's fallen out of fashion. Usually, like, old people wink.
Yes.
You know? It feels like cutesy, but like in a playful way.
That's the thing. It feels like sweet little old grandma or granddad.
Yeah.
That's the energy that it reminds me of.
Maybe this confessional writer is just bringing back winking. We should all just follow suit.
I'll wink at friends playfully sometimes, but I would never do it to a stranger. I would be freaked out if I did that.
Make America wink again.
Or like at a coworker, I would feel embarrassed if I did that too. But you know, this is what the confessional is for. It's for getting out your feelings. If you feel like you can't tell anyone else, this is what we're here for.
So this next confessional writer says that their name is Mel, and they work for the United States Postal Service as a letter carrier. And they write, as we go into the election and Christmas season, I want to let you in on a secret. We work 6 days a week, and I get pummeled by the weight of political mail, Amazon Prime Day packages, and Christmas mail. I often walk 25 miles a day and work 12 hours a day, often from dawn till it's dark. We are being treated horribly by management, and it has recently led to the death of a carrier in Dallas. Our union has abandoned us as we have gone 500 plus days without a contract or raise. Our union president refuses to give any news on other than you'll know more in 2 weeks, which never comes. I caught my wife cheating on me and got divorced, but what gets me through is the customers who light up and are genuinely happy to see me. Thank you for being my people. This one's
wow.
heavy.
Man. Well, that got dark quick. Yeah.
Mel, that sounds really tough. And thank you for everything you do. Yeah. I mean, I never really knew what the day-to-day looked like for postal workers. I have to imagine, though, that during the holiday season, it's insane and people do not have very much grace or patience this time of year, which feels kind of ironic. So thank you for doing what you do. And it kind of says something that someone who's been doing this work says they still get enjoyment out of it when they see their customers light up when they show up with a package, you know? So
yeah.
Do you guys know your mail carriers? Like, 'cause I do.
So no.
Okay.
What do you mean you know them? How do you know
them? Like, I know what their names are, and I know who comes to, like, drop the mail off.
Oh. Ours, we've got a couple.
Okay.
So I don't know them personally, which makes me feel kind of shitty now. I feel like I need to bake them cookies and take it out and be like, thank you for delivering my mail. But it might be different
because do you have a mailbox like out away from your door?
Yes.
Okay. See, that's different. Mine is like right by my door. So that's why. Right.
I can't stand in the entry doorway with my bathrobe and a cup of coffee and wave, hey, Bert, thank you for what you do.
But I can tell that they're understaffed because now, like sometimes they're out there until it's well past dark, even in the summertime. Still delivering mail.
Well, that's what I was going to say. You see these Amazon trucks out sometimes I'm walking Brooklyn 8 or 9 o'clock and they're coming through the neighborhood. I'm like, Jesus.
And to that point, I just saw an ad from Amazon encouraging people to leave the light on if they know they have a package coming like later at night. 'Cause it's hard to like walk. I mean, and I get it because the other day, the Amazon dropped off for one of the neighbors that I don't know very well because they're like a little bit newer, accidentally dropped their Amazon packages off in front of my door. So I just thought I'll just go over and drop them off there. And I was like fearing for my life, just trying to get to their front door because it was so dark in front of their house. Yeah. And then you have to like go in. And then I was like, I can't leave these like outside. And then they had like a Ring doorbell. And I was like, they already saw I'm here. They probably think I'm like a package snatcher. Like, I better just ring the doorbell and be like, hi, I'm your neighbor, just dropping off your shit. But yeah, it was like, it was really dark. So I get it. You know, at least get some motion sensors if you know you're going to have packages coming late, or like leave the light on until they like they're delivered. You know, it's a small thing.
Yeah. And speaking of small things, something I've seen one of my neighbors do for 2 or 3 Christmases now is they'll leave a little like care basket by the front door. Oh, yeah. And there's a note that says, thank you for what you're doing. Feel free to take one of these care packages. And it's got,
so
I don't know, Christmas cookies or stuff in there.
Yeah.
That could be really a nice thing sweet. For people to
I've
do.
I've seen people do that on TikTok. They have like a little snack box.
Yeah, basically.
And water. Like they get like they leave water out so they can.
That's a nice touch. It doesn't, it obviously does not solve everything, the issues that they are facing. But yeah, it's nice to feel acknowledged and appreciated. Like Mel was saying, they like you know, seeing the spark of joy on somebody's face when a package gets delivered. And I think we've all been there too. Like, we get excited to receive certain packages, at least.
Yeah, for sure. And I think we've inspired some holiday cheer for our postal workers in the Discord. Clint said, wow, next time I go to the post office, I'll remember this and ensure I'm extra courteous to the postmaster. Roshni calling out, I didn't realize postal workers don't currently have a contract. April saying, I need to make sure to give my mail carrier some baked goods this month. So definitely a lot of love in here for the postal workers. It's inspiring. I definitely want to do something nice for our delivery person.
Yeah.
You can leave too. Like, I know my mom always has left like a little, like some cash in an envelope and like with a Christmas card.
Oh.
For them and stuff. And
maybe
like
a
that.
Wink too. Little wink emoji on the envelope.
Yeah. Let's go with that. But I think that that's apparently that's common. I didn't realize this because, you know, I think that's it feels like such a grown adult thing to know that you should like tip your postal service people or like your Recology people around the holidays.
Well, take care of yourself, Mel. And thank you for sharing that. We have two more confessionals today. This next one goes, my confession is a weird one. I feel very awkward being a relatively very well-off millennial. My wife and I have been together for a long time and inherited a house when we were in our mid to late 20s. Neither of us comes from crazy generational wealth, and neither of us makes six figures or anything, but we both have decent jobs, and the combination of a mortgage-free home, sharing expenses for the past decade, and stable-ish jobs that we love means that we are very well-off compared to most other people our age. The problem is that I feel very awkward and often guilty for having been so lucky. Our friends are all very cool, but sometimes it can be difficult to navigate the gap in life situations. For example, I've spent years putting time and money into, sometimes very expensive and very necessary, house renovation projects, and budgeting can be stressful, but it is sometimes hard to find a receptive audience to voice this stress to. And I feel bad for feeling stressed about things like this, because why should I be complaining about having to spend money on my house when I have friends who are trying to buy their first home during an increasingly difficult economy? Outside of my immediate friend circle, this is even worse, and I will actively lie about my financial situation to other people because I worry it will make me seem detached, spoiled, or anything else. And then I feel bad for even sending this message because it sounds so much like a humble brag, and because compared to everyone else's problems, who am I to complain about anything? I just feel like I don't deserve to feel stressed or anxious about anything. I fully appreciate how fortunate my wife and I both are, and I am very much not the kind of person to get rich and then immediately change my politics to benefit myself over others. People have tried to convince me to start buying up rental properties, but I refuse to do that on principle. I don't think I have to worry about falling out of touch or about my circumstances turning me into a shitty person. I just wish I didn't feel so guilty. I wish I could live in a world where the kind of stability I enjoy is something that everyone could have. I don't know. Weird confessional. Thanks. That's what the person said.
I mean, first of all, I don't think you need to feel guilty for feeling fortunate. I think a lot of times people, especially people who feel like they are very fortunate, struggle with feeling like, who am I to complain? People have problems that are way worse than mine. And that's true. There are people who do have way worse problems than you. There are problems that you have that are way worse than somebody else who also has problems. So you're allowed to want to vent about these things. I would just say, try to do so to the best extent that you can in a way that's like sensitive.
Yeah.
To maybe other people's situations. Like, even if somebody's not a homeowner and they're not having to deal with, you know, the budget around making home improvements, people who rent also have to have budgets and may have other projects going on. So it could actually open up a really good conversation for you and a friend. Maybe that friend is considering buying a home and they want to learn more about what that's like. And hearing about it from you, a trusted friend, could actually be good for them.
Something that struck me about this is I actually feel this, but from the perspective of, I feel like I operate in a fantasy world in terms of my career. Like, I'm not working in corporate America. I'm working for myself, air quotes. I'm working from home. We do have these podcasts, and then I work for other podcasts. I don't know corporate America. I don't know what people are really going through. So when I try to share my problems, my work problems with other people, I feel like I have no reason to complain, because then I hear their problems and I'm like, oh, wow, you know, that's more serious, at least to me. So I'm trying to unlearn that, because I don't think that's healthy. And I think I need the same reminders that this confessional writer does from the perspective of wealth. So that's something I've talked through in therapy a little bit, because I want to be able to share my problems with friends and, like, you know, talk those things out. But I feel like they aren't up to the problems that my friends have. And thus, why am I bringing them up to begin with? Who cares about your problems, Andrew? You have it good. Yeah,
I think you also kind of have to think about it. Like, you would not, unless you were only friends with fellow coworkers or people that were only in your line of work, you're never going to fully be able to grasp why something is such a big deal if you have friends in, like, other industries, which most people do. Like, I have friends that are in the medical industry. I don't know anything about, like, being a doctor or a nurse, but I'm happy to, like, listen about their, like the drama that's going on.
It's interesting
during like their work day, and I don't mind asking follow-up questions. I think it's like you have to kind of treat it the same way or frame it the same way. Like,
that's a good way to look at it.
Even if you were, like, working for, like, a podcast conglomerate, you would still be talking about, like, your issues would still revolve around, like, editing and having to work with people that are maybe difficult.
Right.
Yeah. But, like, getting back to the confession writer, I think it's good that they're self-aware enough to, like, understand that there's, like, an economic imbalance.
Yeah.
But I would also kind of, like, I guess my question would be, like, when you are talking, because I noticed that they said that like, it's hard to find a receptive audience. I'm wondering if maybe they're leaning too much with, like, the financial burden of how much the repairs cost, or, like, how much they're willing to put into repairs, which maybe might feel out of touch or, like, unattainable to somebody that's making significantly less, and not just, like, lamenting over, like, oh, it's so stressful because my water heater broke, which is something that, like, anybody, to Laura's point, can relate to, you know, just in a different way. Like, if you're renting, for example, like, the issue would probably be, like, getting the landlord to, like, get back to you. And then, like, you as a homeowner, you might be dealing with, like, homeowner's insurance. So it's, like, similar but different. So maybe instead of, like, focusing on the financial burden, like, you could, like, meet in the middle and try and find friends that would relate just to, like, the stress of having to fix stuff. Sometimes it's just about how you frame it. And maybe you're not, like, able to, like, you know, like, it sucks that you're not able to talk about, like, money, if that's what you really want to talk about with people in your circle. But, like, you would at least maybe feel supported in part based on, like, what you're going through.
And I do think social media perpetuates the idea that everybody is poor, suffering. And I think seeing those types of videos often might make you feel even worse about yourself if you are living comfortably, and then you're afraid to bring this type of thing up to your friends because you think that's how everybody thinks. But if these are really your friends, they also should be happy for you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think, you know, to Pam's point, having, like, the sensitivity and the nuance to know how to navigate that conversation is big. But the other thing that I would point out to you is the gap, like, the income and wealth gap between you and your friends is much closer together than the wealth gap between you and all these billionaires. Mm-hmm. I think we, like, as people, get conditioned to fight amongst ourselves and look at, you know, oh, all those people who are making six-figure salaries, let's say, they're the problem. And it's like, they're not really the problem. They're lucky. They're very fortunate that they've got that going for them. But the real problem is the people who are hoarding so much wealth and making it hard to live in this country. So I would just keep that in mind. Also, Roshni said something in our Discord that I thought was really poignant. She said, "I do accept that my problems being different or maybe not as bad doesn't mean they're not hard."
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's a good way to look at it too.
Yeah. All right. One more confessional here. This person writes, "I bailed on my friends and feel awful about it. So we are all learning archery at the moment for fun. Normally we meet for a late breakfast beforehand, which I chose not to attend, and they didn't seem to mind. I left home a few minutes late when driving to the archery center, so was already due to be 10 minutes late. Once I got there, I found parking at the center was impossible, and I couldn't see any nearby parking that looked close enough. I could tell that walking from a nearish parking place would make me half an hour late, so I just completely gave up and continued driving straight back home. I'm fully aware of how much of an asshole I am. I apologize on the group chat and acknowledge that I gave up too easily, and I'm disappointed with myself."
We all have those times where, yeah, like, you know what? I can't turn it on today. There's too much going on. There's too many things going wrong. I'm out this time. And you even apologized. I mean, personally, I probably would have made up a worse excuse, like, you know, just flat out lied.
As long as this is not like a repeat, but something you're doing all the time, I think it's totally fine.
Yeah.
You know, like, you can't find parking, you can't find parking. That's not your fault.
Maybe you also felt bad because you just had some FOMO. You don't want to miss out on this opportunity with your friends.
I did that once. I was supposed to meet up with a group to go see a movie and could not find parking. And I was like, I can't even find parking. I'm not going to be able to find tickets. So sorry, y'all. You're on your own.
Yeah.
Anybody who wants to go to this other theater can with me. But
I actually lied about something to a friend recently to get out of this. And it was, I don't want to, I hesitate to give more. Never mind. I'm going to cut this.
Do you want to keep it in After Dark?
No, it's fine. Forget it.
Well, now we're curious.
It's not that. It's okay. I'll text you guys after.
Okay. I was going to say it's something involving one of us, right?
No, it's not. No, it's about somebody. No. I'll explain later.
Andrew's like, "Oh yeah, there was this one time I told Laura," and then he's like, "Oh fuck."
But yeah, don't feel bad.
No, I think you're being kind of hard on yourself, honestly. Yeah. I mean, I don't have any more context than what was written here. So,
our own worst enemy.
Yeah, I think to Pam's point, if it's not like a chronic issue, I don't think you need to be that worried about it.
It's not like you did it one time and then just like kept not going to archery class or what is it? Was it archery?
It was archery, which is cool. Okay.
I don't know why I almost said axe throwing, which also is cool.
Axe throwing is so much fun.
I've never done it. Okay, oh, we gotta go. Okay, put it in the books.
Thanks, everybody, for all this great feedback today. It was fun catching up on all of it. You can always reach us by DMing us on social media, or you can email millennialshow@gmail.com, or you can use the contact form on millennialshow.com, where you will also find our confessional. Pam, what's coming up in After Dark this week?
We're going to continue with the general theme of gifts from last week, but we're going to use it to talk a little bit of holiday shit. And we're going to talk about gifts that have gone awry. And I know that at least Laura and I have some stories about Christmas fiascos. So we'll be sharing those, and we'll see if Andrew chimes in with anything as well. So it should be fun.
Yeah. After Dark is part of Mega Millennial, which you can get every week when you're a patron or Apple Podcast subscriber. It is also ad-free. So visit patreon.com/millennial to pledge today. Apple Podcast users can just tap into the show and subscribe to the Mega Millennial feed.
Other Patreon benefits include recording studio access, Smart Mouths archives releases, our community Zoom hangouts, and access to our planning meetings. It's easy to get started. Apple Podcasts and Patreon offer 7-day free trials and annual subscription discounts.
What's on deck for Rex, Pam?
I wanted to recommend a book that I'm currently in the middle of reading called Everything I Need, I Get From You, How Fangirls Created the Internet as We Know It. It's by Caitlin Tiffany, who is also a writer at The Atlantic, which is an online publication. And this book is so much fun. It basically, like, the title kind of gives away what it's about, but it's basically about how, like, women in fandom have really shaped not only the internet, but how, like, well fandoms and like certain subsets of fandoms do in the mainstream. And it specifically goes into a lot of how One Direction's popularity is specifically tied to their rise in popularity on Tumblr. So if you were a fan of Tumblr in like 2012 or 2013, kind of like that sweet spot, or were a One Direction fan, or just like a general pop culture fans that enjoys, you know, diving into kind of like the nitty gritty of how all of that affects mainstream media and what gets popular and why, this would be a really fun read for you as well. And it might actually be a good gift for somebody in your life, if you know someone that's feeling especially nostalgic about like the One Direction heyday as well.
Yeah.
So yeah, cool. This has just been so much fun and I'm really enjoying reading it.
I want to recommend a board game. It's called Azul. This is a strategic tile placement game. It's fun for primarily adults, I think, but I think younger kids could play it as well. Basically, the challenge is to create tile mosaics while making strategic decisions and competing for high scores. I've played it a few times now. Beautiful game. If you're looking for a board game recommendation for somebody this Christmas, definitely check it out.
And I want to recommend an anime on Netflix called Dandadan. They're dropping episodes weekly on Thursdays. We are getting kind of late in the season, but it has been such a fun watch. It is unapologetically weird at times and also just so quirky and funny. But what I love about it is the emotional reactions really do run the spectrum with this show. It'll have you laughing out loud, but it'll also have you in tears in the next episode. It's really been a fun watch. It's about extraterrestrial and paranormal things. So if you're into creepy shit like I am and funny, weird animes like I am, then I think you'll like this.
All right, pals, time for a couple of reminders.
First up, we want to remind you once again that the Millennial merch store is officially open. So head on over to shop.millennialshow.com to check out our collection of custom hoodies, shirts, including the brand new For the Show shirt that Andrew mentioned at the top of the show. We have drinkware, we have tote bags, and so much more. So head on over and check those out. And if you end up purchasing anything, thank you in advance, firstly. But also be sure to tag us on social media because we want to see you guys enjoying the stuff that we made for Definitely. You all. So yeah, share that with us, please.
Thanks, everyone. And make sure you're following the show in your favorite podcast app so you never miss an episode. And we would love a review in Apple Podcasts or Spotify. And also don't forget that we're now releasing video episodes on YouTube. After Dark starts in a moment for patrons and Apple Podcast subscribers. Thanks, everybody, for listening. I'm Andrew.
I'm Laura.
And I'm Pamela.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.